And if you trace the literature, literature has been there, it's coming. So I have not started on my slides, so I'm just giving some background. It has been there for at least 30 years. And earlier, it came in the context of Latin American water privatization experiment very strongly. And then African experiments. And then now it is coming again in the context of the PPPs, because after the privatization experiments failed in those two continents somewhat, when in search of middle grounds, the partnership idea was thrown and broadly accepted in developing countries, especially South Asian countries, again this publicness, commonness or privateness has come up once again in the discussion. So how really PPPs are changing our, whether and how PPPs are changing our understanding of publicness, or how it is really, I mean, does it have any potential to really change the concept, change the idea, change the understanding, and also how finally it really influences the design of the institutional mechanism which finally delivers the water services. That is the context in which we are talking. Well, if we look at the very main sort of established perspective in economics, Shoman in the morning was talking about this, that excludability and rivalry are the two criteria to define public good. And if you look at water, water is definitely excludable. Water is rivalrous, and hence very often water is not really considered as a pure public good. But there is a concept of merit good in economics, and sometimes I really resort to this concept of merit good when I think about water, because this under-provisioning of water when water is left to market forces can be really very easily seen in the practice. And under-provisioning may be in the form of quality of water when it comes for drinking, maybe in the form of under-irrigation when it goes to irrigation or agriculture sector, and so on. So can really merit good is an alternative to this public and common and private debate is one of the questions right away, right now, I would like to throw forward this question. If you look at the privateness, generally it is understood that the unit of extraction as well as the value addition indicates its commodification when we think of the water. For example, the quota for irrigation or the quota for domestic, for how many acres have been assured in an irrigation command, brings the privateness element to that, because it is consumed at a family level, or the liters per capita per day kind of a norm which comes through the government policy, which attaches the privateness and also then brings some kind of exchangeability, creates the possibility of exchanges or trading, at least conceptually. Whether it is practiced or not, there are a couple of examples in Australia and US where exchangeable entitlements are being practiced. Murray Darling is a very common example of that. Even Chile throws one such example. So this is how privateness is also sort of attached to water. Commonness, yes, after the Hardin's and Nostrom's work, where the entire idea of a third possibility, which is neither states, not market, but water as a common and common good and then common property regime kind of an institution can be explored, that has very strongly come. And if you look at this, we do understand that at a watershed level, at a basin level, commons can be conceptualized. We can see the boundaries, and we can also think about some kind of institution where community-driven, user-managed systems can be established, where the common good kind of an idea comes very strong. But when we again look at in between, within the watershed, for example, a dam serving multiple purposes, which is within the watershed of an entire river, a basin, you see that several purposes can be served by dam water, maybe irrigation, maybe industry, maybe domestic for cities and villages. And then if you look at the current practices, there are basin level organizations still, I mean, we have not seen really functioning very well from the commons kind of a perspective, but rather we are more often seeing it as a public good because state institutions have been involved to manage this kind of this resource at within the watershed at dam. And if you look at an aquifer level, which is underground, which is more difficult in terms of finding the boundary of the resource, which is very, very important to understanding the commons kind of a perspective, it is very often argued that aquifer is a right unit. If you identify the boundaries, you can bring commons kind of institutions to manage the resource. But still there is a confusion how commons as well as publics have overlapping understanding or overlapping kind of, are those basically overlapping concepts. And last but not least, if you look at this entire context of water as essential for life, it is often related to the human rights perspective, and that's how human rights have been argued. Now, on this background, how PPP comes into the sector and how it changes the entire understanding of public versus common or private or even human right is very, very interesting to see. So I'm trying to throw some of the contradictions as the concept gives us a certain understanding, but PPP comes, PPP interprets in a different way, and also then it changes our whole understanding about commons or public. That's the attempt I'm going to have. So on this background, often the question is which institutional mode or model can best ensure this? The access. Ensure this, meaning I'm hinting at the access. We have very well, we know all this. Theory has established that market can fail, and even you look at the water, most of the water provisioning systems are national monopolies. Competition by the nature, by the characteristic of the system itself is very difficult to bring in. Although there have been attempts in different ways to bring in competition on general basis, how you award contracts from 2 years to 3 years to 1 year basis. But that is not the kind of competition which perfect competition kind of scenario really conceptualizes. And so, when those are national monopolies, that can really compromise the public merit good of element of the water. So market can definitely fail there, no doubt. If you look at the theory of the state failure, yes, rent seeking, we have been, I'm particularly using some of the concepts from economics. Rent seeking, which is very commonly attached with the state, the theory of state failure. Political expediency, which is in other words, Karen Baker also calls it as poacher gamekeeper problem. So a lot of conflicts of interest within, if the all functions like policy making, delivery of the services and regulation of the services handled by a particular agency, the state. And also if it is handled by the private, if the delivery, then there is, and Stiglitz, someone mentioned in the morning session, talks about the regulatory capture. So the state failure is very much there in the context of water. Market failure is very much in the context of water. And if we look at, especially if I refer to the entire governance theory discourse from the political science, where governance has been conceptualized as the engagement between the state and non-state actors, then Bob Jessop has told us much earlier that governance can also fail, and Karen Baker has shown it through her work in the Jakarta paper that how even governance has failed to ensure the access in the PPP. So if all these three institutional models have the possibility of failure, does this understanding of public or common or private and these attached institutional models with each of the understanding are going to inform us in some way that which really should be the institutional mechanism to ensure equitable access to water? That's the question which I would like to put. Of course, I do not have answer, but as a background, I'm using this. Now, on this background, if you look at the Indian case, I see that whether state really succeed or fail has been an unresolved debate. On one hand, if you look at the progress of the urban water supply systems in India, 90% of urban water supply systems have been built in the state resources. And those are in the form of grants as well as soft loans by public institutions, which state has repaid. So not those, all the loans have been recovered from tariffs. Wherever tariffs could not repay it completely, state has put in its own resources to pay back the loans. Loans have been also given by the public institutions, public financial institutions. Not often private finance has really come in building the huge infrastructure which you see in Indian cities. But this entire progress has been marred by differential access, and differential access is very common in Indian cities. And if you look at the surveys in 1970s, 80s, 90s, 2005, the famous ADB benchmarking survey in 2007, all show this particular reality in the urban areas in India. So unreliable supply is the one feature of that. Elites and middle classes resorting to self-provision, very easily you access groundwater and you sort of resort to groundwater as your source of water because your public systems are not functioning well. Poor maintenance of infrastructure leading to high levels of contamination of pure water supply. You spend a lot in purification, but still you supply contaminated water. And then we have discussed a lot in the morning about slums and especially informal settlements who do not have formal access by law despite the policy of universal access, which is very much there in the constitution. We can have references to it. Despite that, they have been deprived of formally accessing the water from the public. So, whether this failed or whether this succeeded is still an unresolved, because on one hand there is a great contribution by state in building the systems, and whatever access is free today is has been provided by the state, but there are issues in the practice. And then in the context of reforms, after India sort of opened its economies in 1990 and accepted broadly neoliberal agenda of reforms, this question has been increasingly asked, that is the public spending on the water the way it finds. If you look at again some of the data, Planning Commission of India has been crying, literally crying, appealing from 1965 for recovering the operation and maintenance cost. And then I have a question for all of us to discuss. Does this cost recovery as a principle, bringing in the public systems, really compromise the publicness of water or our understanding of public good? After 1970s, the major urban water supply schemes were financed through public sector financial institutions via state boards. Loans were never ever recovered. That I just said in the last slide as well. So is water or is the water supply system's characteristic itself is such that people can't pay to recover the costs, capital as well as the operation and management costs of water, then why there has been much focus on cost recovery even before reforms landed in India in 1990s? Because 1965 is way back, just after 15 years of independence we are talking about. A few state boards for urban water as well as irrigation project issued bonds, and sort of a crowdfunding in today's terminology. People can invest in their bonds and they get returns at fixed interest rates, but those also even fail to pay back the interest, and every now and then state revenues have to support these kinds of financing schemes to repay the loans through bonds as well as through public financial institutions. So the question is, doesn't accessing private capital compromises the publicness here? Again a question, because when we talk about public-private interaction, municipal bonds or bonds issued by parasitical agencies in India also access, in a sense, private capital or private sector. So, what were the driving forces for reforms? I'll quickly go over this because we have been talking about this a lot. One is definitely this entire thing was begun with the DFID, USAID, ADB and other agencies doing such a kind of systematic studies on performance evaluation of the Indian water utilities. When we talk about performance evaluation, we eventually talk about efficiency, and then we get into the debate which is also like public versus private, efficiency versus equity kind of benefit. And it comes back again and again in water sector, in any literature you find out about whether state functioning of the state institutions or the agencies. Leading this to the facilitation of local discourses, which and Vandana Astana has really worked very, very nicely on this particular aspect. And local discourses on inefficiency and state failure. And the state started accepting that they have failed, like it happened everywhere, even in UK and US during Thatcher and Reagan era. And the two core elements of diagnosis come. One is the financial crisis, because you do not have enough capital to finance the water supply systems, which are heavily capital-oriented, capital-intensive. And you have accountability crisis, and the typical argument which World Development Report 2004 of the World Bank gives. And it argues that a market is more effective mechanism for extracting the accountability, because you have the shorter route where the supplier or the provider has to be accountable to the buyer or consumer. Otherwise, he would not sustain in the market. Instead, rather, as a longer route via political representatives and frontline providers, which is becoming very, very difficult for me, which is the mechanism which makes very difficult for people to extract the accountability from the system. Now, there are certain technological issues, and one has to at least touch upon them when one talks about urban water supply systems. When I say by nature those are capital intensive and those are natural monopolies, because the choice of purified or safe, or what government used to call in earlier policy papers as protected pipe water supply, as a technology choice, leads to this high capital intensive character of water supply system. Because you need huge pipes, big grid, dam to tap, and huge capital which is required. And if you do not provide enough financing through the public systems or the private system, then you often resort to, because World Bank and ADB loans are much cheaper than the other development financing options in India at 4% to 5%. And then that's our entire context of multinational financial institutions or international financial institutions. Second, the another argument for efficiency, if you want to curb inefficiency, that is physical leakages as well as you have to have consumption-based tariffs for recovering costs. And that's the very different kind of an interpretation of the term equity, which the mainstream does. Because if a family of 5 people are paying the same tariff and family of 10 people are paying the same tariff, but their consumption is differential, it is inequitable. And this argument has been bought very rapidly in the policy circles. And hence, consumption-based tariffs are equitable, and those also help you to recover costs because you can bill according to the consumption. So that is one. And which requires, again, technology is related there, continuous water supply system model. Because if you want to measure accurately consumed water, your pipes needs to be full 24 hours. Otherwise, in intermittent supply system, what happens is air passes through the meter, and then you have errors in your billing, and then there is resistance from people who say that we haven't consumed it, you are forcing us to pay. But 24/7, I mean, continuous water supply system design and maintenance, again, is a capital intensive. And that's how it is leading to a different kind of financialization, a different kind of than what is happening in UK or other parts of Europe, where you create, basically, sectoral needs, assess sectoral demands of finances, and then try to mobilize finance through international and national banks. So that's, and some of the statistics which come through the expert committees and other agencies studies is the entire India level demand was 305 billion rupees in 1996. In 2005, it went up to 1505 billion rupees. And by 2030, the prediction is 1.2 trillion rupees of investment is needed in Indian urban water sector alone. On these issues, on the background again from these issues, if you look at the journey of PPPs in India from 1990 to 2012, you will find that none of the single PPP has gone ahead. All the PPPs are stagnated, and there are several reasons. Professor Abhay Pethe was talking about the risk sharing issues in the morning, and that has been at the core of the negotiations between public and private when it came to the contract negotiations over the PPPs. So, in the 1990s to 2005 projects, all tried with 100% private investment, none survived except Tirupur, and Tirupur also died because of the global recession because their entire model of tariff was based on cross-subsidy where industry had to pay and subsidize for domestic, but industry faced the recession, their exports came down and industry stopped buying water from the utility, and the entire Tamil Nadu government had to take over entire operations, and again it went into the public. So even the practice or the attempts of PPPs are showing us somewhere the some of the structural issues involved in the way PPPs have been designed and attempted to roll out. In from 2000 to 2004, 6 management contracts, 1 build, operate, own, operate and transfer contract. This is all the standard terminology laid by IFIs, which are very often quoted as different types of PPPs. And most of these were public funded, and none of them again could go ahead. Only 1 O&M contract has survived, 1 good contract has been survived, but soon it failed. And 1 DBO sort of is still surviving. But here, important point is, classically, the private finance is not involved here. In the infrastructure building, entire money is coming from the public institutions. From 2004 to 10, again, 13 private companies are local. I am trying to give you a micro view of one of these PPPs, just to get into the details of how it was tried, operated, and how it got stuck. And in between 15 years of stagnation, what has happened to the water supply system in that city, and where is the project now? And both, it's very interesting stuff. It comes from my PhD case. And this is a city in Maharashtra called Aurangabad. In fact, it is the place where Suhas comes from. And they tried to, they put a proposal to the government in 2005 to lay a parallel pipeline from a dam so that the entire quantum of water, the volume of water which comes to the city can be increased, doubly. Because city has been suffering long and it didn't have enough water to distribute, although the distribution system also was suffering from the issue. If you look at the entire journey from 2006 to 2015, you will see that the special purpose vehicle, which was formed in the name of Aurangabad City Water Supply Company, where three companies have put their equity and also took some debt, and part of the money also came from government, took almost 10 years to even sign, finalize and start the operations. What has happened in between? Some of the issues which Professor Abhipeti was talking about in the morning, the capability issues, the capacity issues of local governments, they can't understand the terminology, they need to be trained, or even if they can't absorb it, they need to have another support agencies like from the private sector like CRISIL as transaction advisors. So entire bidding process of selection of consortiums of companies have been advised by the private themselves, and public officials were just there sitting and signing the things. And then the political fights within and out about how to enter into this PPP business was one of the attempts made by the local politicians, which I sometimes jokingly called as political entrepreneurship or entrepreneurial politics, whatever it is, where the boundary really blurs between a political representative who tries to invest in the public water supply system and tries to earn some kind of both illicit as well as legal income. So this all negotiations took this long and still the PPP is stagnated. In between, what happened, that parallel pipeline project was expanded so that the private company can enter in, and new tasks were designed in that entire project which were aimed at refurbishing the entire distribution system in the city. And that also took a lot of time. Why project delayed? Very interesting. The local corporators, local media, local civil society kept in dark to the extent possible about what is happening behind the curtains in terms of negotiation, even including the selection of the bidder, selection of the company, setting the criteria for companies for qualification, etc., etc. And the criteria was set in such a way that one company which was interested there already to get into that, criteria was designed in a very, very suitable way so that that company and its consortium can automatically qualify as the potential company with whom the contract can be signed. The negotiation among leaders about who will take the contracts, because when this new system is coming, the old system, where the corporators and politicians have their own nexuses with the contractors who get regular works of maintenance and new infrastructure as well, came in the danger. So entire earlier system of operation has to be replaced with this new PPP kind of a regime. How to retain your interest? Because those interests are not only about earning money or earning illicit income, but it is also about how do you sustain your political regime informally within the party. How do you create work for your patron, your clients, and entire in the context of entire patron-client relationship? And so all these questions also took a lot of time. State government deliberately, very interestingly, because the oppositional party was in the power and the local government was formed by a different party, so both were in opposition, deliberately delayed the PPP to give a post-facto approval to the bylaws, because before the PPP comes into picture, the municipal corporation has to declare its own bylaws for water, which have to be followed by the citizens of that city or residents of that city, whatever. And lot of time. This led to controversies about illicit engagement of leaders in the project. Media was very active. And this entire controversy passed through three elections in 15 years, and despite all this, contract was signed. And then the company which was entered into the contract lost its money, lost the investment, it sold out its stakes, and between the mergers and acquisitions, there were certain issues which went into court, and five different public interest litigations were filed in the court, and those are still going on. Whereas, if I mean, methodologically I can't talk counterfactually, but if I assume that had that project would have been rolled out through the state funding, the situation would have been much different in terms of access. Not ideal, definitely, but not so worse, because in between what has happened is, in summer the frequency of water supply through public water system was once in a week, which has reached to once in 15 days, and in summer season it even went to once in 20 days. That is the level of deprivation in some, even today, Aurangabad people are suffering. This has upscaled the cost because inflation are there, and anyway, upscaling the cost overruns is a very, very common phenomenon we have observed across the countries when globalization is accepted. So this is nothing new. In 2009-10, it was 792,000 and it went up to 1,200,000 or I'm not able to calculate that in the millions and trillions, sorry. So how actually, what kind of really networks have been formed in this entire case? One type is key political leaders having connections with connections across the parties, where the larger exchange is about getting the approval for the PPP, negotiating from about the benefits of the PPP, which politicians would be reaping, etc., etc., happened. The second network which emerged was the bureaucrats across the tier of government. Why I'm talking about across the tier of government? Because the approvals have to come from the central government and the state government. Then only you can go and implement it in local government. So across the tier of the government for upward mobility. If I show that I have been successfully managing this PPP at a local level, I have a chance to, you know, promotions. Network three, which is cross-cutting, politicians, bureaucrats, private consultants, private companies, all have direct gains if this is implemented, apart from the public. And network type 4, local politicians and local contractors and local political workers who are trying to explore spaces in the new regime for their own sustainability, how they were sustainable earlier. So, if you just map on a scale how this interest influence matrix really looks at, if you look at the low-rank staff in the water utility of the public and the municipal board, they have very high interest, but they have, you know, very low influence. Citizens, very high interest, NGOs, very high interest, but they were denied the information, very non-transparent operations, they have very, very low influence. If you look at the judicial system, it has very high influence, because it is not really working to resolve this issue of really that has been observed. If you look at politicians, consultants, bureaucrats, companies, they are managing the entire scene, even in the mergers and acquisitions. So everyone says, look, this project is not feasible. The project has cost has reached up to 1200 crores. This means the original cost was 392 in the original proposal, which was the public funding. But the difference is 818 crores. And this much of money has to be put in by a company which is called Accessibility, which is also a television company, a big, big profitable television company in India. Why it got into utilities, I don't know. Must be a lot of camera completion. And who has already invested more than 200 crores in their time? They are trying to sell them the SPV shares. Bank is not approving the loan for the SPV, even if they are approved. Who will be suffering? Bank has the public money. So people in the society has already started opposing the retailing, because retailing is the final kind of resort for any private company, because through that only it would be able to calculate its revenues and revenue scenarios, how much it could be generated, because it has to be built on the measurement of the consumption. So why companies investing? That is one of the questions I was very interested in. Possibility one, to gain experience, but this is a very mundane answer given by any company. It is not true, I don't believe in that. SL Utilities has subcontracted every function, knowing the political risk involved, and SL Utilities can wrap up any time. It is already having water supply projects elsewhere, and it can really run away. Possibility two, the political exchange due to political pressure from local ruling party to salvage the scheme, because earlier companies have left and they are accountable to people, so there is some democratic frame operating there. Because water is a very, very sensitive, emotional kind of a good, I would say. And in the local democratic format, when the same corporators sign contract and the same corporators or public representatives lead the protest, there this entire tension and tussle between the opportunities to earn illicit income as well as retain the publicness of the water can be seen really. Possibility three, that together enough plate, you have 25 crores worth contract because you are supporting politicians there, even if you are increasing losses, and then you can launch an IPO in Bombay Stock Exchange and raise more capital. So all these three possibilities are there, and still it is going on like that. how did this compromise the public sphere? That is the major question, I mean, in the context of PPPs. So if you look at it, does, because hierarchical and centralized structure of informal powerful networks outside the state ULB relationship rule the decision making. State ULB relationship in the sense state government and ULB in a formal way, how the approvals have been sent and etc. It has completely depoliticized the process, at least the decision making process, through co-opting and marginalizing the corporators, the local representatives in the local government and local media and civil society. Because it kept every dependency of ULB over state and central government for approvals. So in a sense, the PPP is, I look at it as the tip of the iceberg, because the whole structural reform has to come first. And then your PPP can come and can be implemented at local level. So you have to decentralize systems first. Then you have to corporatize systems. And then you can create enough ground when PPP kind of a frame, kind of an institution comes and start operating. But if you look at it, look at this case in the decentralization context, every dependency of the local government has been on the state. So decentralization objective has been also completely defeated. And then gradual shrinkage of the ULB, because you will see empty office in the water utility of the ULB, because the entire operations have been transferred to the company. And also with that, transferred accountability to provide water to the company, where company is no longer accountable to people, company is accountable only for itself. Whether PPP led to efficiency, well, the story speaks for itself, I will not spend much time on that. But what PPP did, it increased new opportunities for existing cost structures to gain firmer grip. How this entire reform can be manipulated and used to retain the existing cost structure and also find some kind of opportunity to earn more, to build more firmer political, informal political relationships from the earlier system, that is definitely happening. And a more legitimate model for business in public services, because corporators are contractors, most of the cities in India those are, and Aurangabad is not an exception. In water supply related functions, including the billing and collection, including the maintenance of works, and if PPP happens, in the earlier state model that was sort of undercover, but here you can very clearly and without any guilt, despite you are a political representative, you can engage in this water business. And that's what PPP is trying to do. Yeah.
Thank you.
So, this is PPP, but I wanted to also talk quickly about the entire public good in the form of human rights, because this is a big debate in India, and human rights has been understood in various ways. If you look at the constitutional provision, it says that right to water as a derivative right from the right to life in India, and that's how courts have given judgment. The established that. If you look at the right to water discourse, it seems to be settling down at 135 liters per capita. 135 liters per capita per day or 700 liters per family per day by allowing higher consumption at higher cost to many customers. And this can be ensured in the PPP model as well, because if this basic need is subsidized by state by giving direct transfer for that cost to the public private corporations, your right is ensured. So PPP and human rights is a very interesting mix. In case of slums, very interesting, and this is really, really surprising, that in case of slums, the recent Mumbai High Court ruling, one of the movement in Mumbai, which is known as Right to Water Committee, has filed a PIL in Mumbai High Court on the issue of denial of formal access to the illegal slums, because those have legal issues and property relationship issues and informal settlements, etc. Court gave ruling is that right to water of slum dwellers cannot be considered at par with the legal options. So how can you really create differential rights? I mean, right is right. I mean, human right to water is right. Fine. But court itself is saying that this right is not at par with that right. And on one hand, you talk about right to water and universal access. So very interestingly, these two incidences, one interpreting 135 LPCD through a private public-private partnership as right and legitimizing it. Second, you are saying that these two rights are not at par, really trying to change our understanding, because this ruling has implications that you can provide water through water ATMs, you can provide water through water tankers, you can provide water through informal markets, and that can also be considered as municipal corporation is delivering its responsibility, the public responsibility. So, very complex debate, and I would like to end with this. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.